to God in prayer. God, we thank you for this time that you give us. Lord, what a blessing it is to carve out some time in our week, to carve out some time in our day, to spend in your presence, and to spend with your word. God, we pray that as we reflect on the scriptures this morning, as we reflect on the role that your word plays in our lives, on the place it occupies, that you would give us eyes to see you and ears to hear you. You would give us hearts and minds that are open to the work that you're doing in this world, in our homes, and in our life, as we seek you. So in the name of your son, Jesus, that we pray these things. Amen. Some of you may be familiar with the life and works of Martin Luther. I've talked about Martin Luther a number of times from this pulpit. Countless books have been written about this historical figure. A few years ago, there was a pretty good movie that was made about his life. The fact is, Martin Luther is one of the great heroes of the faith. For 500 years, the Protestant church has looked to Luther as someone who was willing to take a risk, someone who was willing to stand up for what he believed to be right, someone who was willing to proclaim the word of God, even if it cost him his life. Martin Luther was a man who, maybe more than any other, started the Protestant Reformation when he nailed his 95 theses to the door of the Wittenberg Church on October 31st, 1517. This would eventually lead to the breaking away of numerous believers from the authority of the Pope, and it would set off a whole series of changes, both inside and outside the Roman Catholic Church, that have led to the shape of the Church, both the Catholic Church and the Protestant Church today. And I mention Martin Luther this morning not because this year marks the 500th anniversary of that stand that he took, but because today we're going to begin a new series of sermons focusing on the book of James, or the Epistle of James. James is a short book. It's just 5 chapters. It's stuck near the back of your New Testament, somewhere between the letters of Paul and the prophecies of Revelation. But even though James is short, even though this book sometimes flies under the radar, this book is full of things that are worthy of our attention. Over the past couple of months, I've mentioned to a few of you that I'm planning on preaching through James as we move into the new school year. A number have responded by saying that you really love this book, that the book of James has been a source of inspiration and education to you over the years, that it's one of your favorite parts of the New Testament. And I agree with that assessment. And that's why I want to spend some time talking about this letter. But not everyone agrees. Maybe most famously, Martin Luther, the great Protestant reformer, the hero of Western Christianity, had some less than favorable things to say about the letter of James. In the preface of his German translation of the New Testament, Luther went into great detail about how much he loved the writings of Paul and Peter and the Gospels, and he commended these works to his readers as books that would aid them in their faith. Then he said, in comparison with these, James seems to be an epistle full of straw, because it contains nothing evangelical. In other words, Luther was sort of relegating James to a secondary status. He was even questioning its validity as a biblical book. He was saying that, basically, from his perspective, James was kind of flimsy and second-rate when compared to the rest of the New Testament. One gets the feeling that if Martin Luther had been in charge of the books that made it into the scriptures, and if he had had the decision about which books got in and which books got left out, the Epistle of James would have found itself on the scrap heap with a lot of other well-written but unsacred writings from the first century. We certainly wouldn't be setting off as a congregation through these chapters in the hopes that God will use the words on these pages to speak to us. Now, we could just simply forget what Luther said about James. After all, there's a lot of stuff that Martin Luther said and did that I'm not particularly crazy about. He never claimed to be perfect. I'm sure he would be the first to say that his opinion of a book of the Bible was just that. It's an opinion to be dealt with as we see fit. But I think it would be more interesting here at the beginning of our own study of James, this epistle of straw, to think about what Luther's attitude might tell us about our own attitude. What does it mean that one of the most historically important Christians of all time, a man who thought that the Bible was important enough that he risked his life translating it into German, what does it mean that he thought that this letter, James, was largely insignificant for his life and for the faith? What might it say about how we as Christians sometimes view the scriptures? How we read these words that we claim have been given to us by God? How we make room in our lives for the Bible, all of it, from Genesis to Revelation, including those parts that sometimes we just as soon not have to deal with? See, the place of scripture in our lives cannot be overestimated. We need to keep making room in our daily existence for the attitudes and the beliefs and the practices that scripture lays out for us. And that begins when we come to a common understanding of what scripture is, why we read the Bible in the first place, why it would be so important for us to have the Bible on our shelves, and even more important for us to take it down and look at it. Because if Martin Luther, of all people, had some struggles when it came to reconciling his personal feelings about scripture with the need to study and to learn the Word of God, it's a pretty safe bet that some of us might struggle with some of these same things as well. So to begin with this morning, I want us to spend a little bit of time thinking about some of the attitudes and approaches to Scripture that are out there that might trip us up. Now, these things aren't necessarily wrong in and of themselves, but if we take them to be the whole story about what the Bible is, we'll come up short. We'll miss out on what God really wants us to take away from our encounter with His Word. So for far too many people, the idea behind Bible reading is that we do it because it will make us feel better about ourselves. For a lot of Christians, the Bible is kind of an ancient compendium of warm fuzzies that are guaranteed to give us a positive, maybe even a rosy outlook on life. Now, before I go any further, I should clarify that the Bible is a book of hope. In fact, the Bible is the only book in which we can find true hope. The promises of God that are contained in the Scriptures, the truths that the Bible speaks about God's love for us, the great lengths that God would go to in order to show that love. All of these things are a necessary part, maybe the most significant part, of that good news that Jesus and Paul and Martin Luther talked so much about. The Bible is a book of good news. That's what gospel means. And so reading this book should make us feel good. Not in a superficial way, like how an ice cream cone makes us feel good, but in a far deeper, far more lasting way. Like the way we feel when we receive a loving embrace from a parent or a child or a spouse. Like how we feel when we know that justice has triumphed over evil, when we know that healing in life have overcome death. See, these are the sorts of things we encounter in the Bible. And these are, without a doubt, the best news that we could ever hear. But there's also another side to the Scriptures, something that the feel-good gospel sometimes ignores. Because in addition to being a narrative of hope and joy and salvation, the Bible is also an age-old story of rebellion and sin and shame. Before we were saved, before we were encouraged and lifted up out of the pit, we as human beings spent a very long time making our way down into the muck and the mire. Before there was deliverance, there was despair. And so when we come to the Scriptures, in addition to being encouraged by passages like Psalm 23, which talks about God being our shepherd, which talks about God bringing us to lie beside still waters, we also need to read Matthew 3, where John the Baptist calls the religious people of his day a brood of vipers. We need to read Matthew 23, where Jesus calls some of those same people whitewashed tombs. Or Romans 5, where Paul tells us that in our sin we were God's enemies. My point is that if our only Bible reading we ever do is from a positive thought that we get in our email every day, or from a coffee table devotional book that has flowers or rainbows on the cover, then we might not get the whole story. The Bible is meant to encourage us. The Bible is meant to give us hope in a dark world. But when we are contributing to the darkness because of our disobedience, we are contributing to the state of the world because of our hardness of heart, then the Bible can actually make us feel pretty bad about ourselves sometimes. So that will change. We might want to avoid those passages, but they're in there. And if we're going to take our Bible seriously, if we're going to take Scripture as God's Word, we have to take those things into account. Well, the second way that people often use the Scriptures selectively is to affirm what we already know to be true. So just as we won't always want to look at the judgment passages because they might challenge our lifestyles, there might also be some passages in the Bible that we might want to avoid because they challenge our beliefs about God. I think a lot of times we come to the Scriptures assuming that we're right and everyone else is wrong. And so we read these words selectively. We often try to twist them to fit our own cultural or political or personal agendas. And in all of this manipulation, something gets lost. I think that this might be one of the mistakes that Martin Luther made when he came to the Epistle of James. Martin Luther had a very significant, very important, and very personal understanding of what Christianity was all about. And I'll admit that Martin Luther knew more about the gospel message than I probably ever would. But when he came across some things in James that conflicted with his own preconceived belief system, he called these things into question, rather than taking a step back and letting these scriptures speak to him, letting these scriptures even challenge his own perspective. The religious leaders in Jesus' day made some similar mistakes. In John chapter 5, verse 39, Jesus tells the Pharisees that they diligently studied the scriptures because they thought that by them they could possess eternal life. Jesus says, "These are the scriptures that testify about me, but you refuse to come to me to have life." See, these people of Jesus' day thought that they had the word of God figured out. But when Jesus, the true word of God, stood before them, sent straight from the Father, they were unwilling to listen because some of the things that he was saying challenged some of their preconceived notions, some of their perceptions. Sometimes when we read Scripture, we think that everything we read will fit into the neatly ordered system that we have of the way the world works. And that isn't always the case. There are going to be things in Scripture that really challenge us, things that turn our worlds upside down, things that turn our thoughts inside out. And when this happens, the best thing to do is not to ignore it, not to resist it, not to avoid it, but to bear with it, to continue to push into the Scriptures, to continue to study and to ask questions and to let these words shape us, rather than trying to push and pull and twist these words into whatever we want them to say. Well, on a related note, we want to be careful about reading Scripture as though it were a kind of weapon with which we can win arguments, or something that we can use to prove how smart we are. See, if my first two points are right, that Scripture is here to convict us, and that Scripture will also usually stretch and challenge us, then the idea that we have a corner on the Bible, the idea that we can make the Word of God into our possession or our tool, can be pretty dangerous. Paul says in Romans 3 that whatever the law says, it says to those who are under the law, so that every mouth may be silenced and the whole world held accountable to God. In other words, whatever we think Scripture says to our enemies, whatever we think Scripture says to those who think or believe or behave differently than we do, it also says the same thing to us. Jesus' enemies were constantly using Scripture as a weapon or as a snare in order to trap Jesus in his words. They thought they were pretty smart in this. They thought that by using God's word, Jesus wouldn't be able to argue. What they didn't count on was that Jesus would be able to show them and the crowds how Scripture spoke directly to them as well. That he would know enough to realize that they were the ones who were guilty of what they were falsely accusing him of. So we might think that we're in a position of authority because we read our Bibles, or because we understand on some level what God is saying to this world. And that's true. God has given us his word so that we can speak with authority on matters. But whenever we try to beat people down with this stuff, whenever we try to use the Bible as a weapon, we run the risk of destroying ourselves in the process. The Bible will hold us all accountable. And so we come to this world as messengers, rather than as judges. We share the message of hope and judgment with those who will hear it and those who will receive it. So what can we expect when we come to the Scriptures? What can we expect from a book like James, which we're going to kind of jump into next week? A book which might not be full of warm fuzzies. It might not be full of a lot of tools for winning arguments, but which is nonetheless a necessary part of our Christian life. Well, since we're going to be spending the next several weeks in this book, I thought it would be good for us to think about what we will be encountering. And as a way of doing so, let's sort of return to Luther's ill-advised statement that this book, the book of James, is an epistle of straw. Now, he obviously meant this as a negative thing, like when the author of The Three Little Pigs depicts one of the pigs building his house out of straw, or when we talk about a straw man who can be so easily overcome in debate or battle. See, Luther meant to articulate that in his perspective, James was something unimpressive, less worthy. But what if we think more about this image of straw? What is it that we can learn from Luther's description about the book of James, and then how it might apply to Scripture as a whole? What does straw do? Well, first of all, straw is good for starting a fire. It can be used as tinder to get a flame going in a pinch, because it burns easily. It burns quickly. The Word of God, even a book like James, can function in the same way. I think that when we look at a lot of our lives, one of the things we're missing is fire. One of the things we're missing is the sort of vitality and inspiration, the desire and the passion for God that we so desperately need. And so, in a lot of our lives, we're kind of missing out on the abundance that God has planned for us because we find ourselves sleepwalking through our days and nights. We need someone or something to get us going. We need someone to light a fire in our bellies, to put us to work for the kingdom. Sometimes all we need is a spark. An encounter with the Word of God, even a challenging or difficult part of Scripture, can provide this. The book of James, which we'll be looking at over the next few weeks, is full of powerful calls to action. It's full of challenges to us to rise above mediocrity, to live the on-fire lives that God has called us to live. In unassuming and in sometimes surprising ways, these words can provide the fuel we need to get our hearts burning for God, to step into the path that God has laid out for us. Well, second use of straw is found in the process of decision-making. It's not something we do much anymore, but historically, people have drawn straws to settle on a course of action. This might be seen as a matter of luck. It might be seen as a matter of blind fortune, kind of like a roll of the dice. But to a lot of cultures, drawing straws or casting lots has often been viewed as one of the ways in which God works. Outcomes aren't viewed as arbitrary or coincidental, but as divinely ordained. But whether you think this is superstitious or not, the fact remains that all of us at one time or another have been in desperate need of guidance. We need to find something beyond ourselves that will lead us in the right direction. And if we truly believe, as Paul tells Timothy, that Scripture is God-breathed, if we truly believe that the Bible is useful for teaching and rebuking and correcting and encouraging, that it is a true source of wisdom, then we will turn to God's Word when we need to make a decision. We'll prayerfully examine the principles of Scripture in order to determine a course of action. We'll talk about it with others who are reading it alongside us, and we'll treat what it tells us with respect. Finally, we use straw for protection and cover. If you were to go out to our garden plot in the backyard, you would see this. When we plant seed, when we plant other plants, it's common to scatter straw over the seed or sprouts until they grow. And straw here can protect the seeds in the young plants from too much wind or water erosion, or maybe from birds or other animals that would otherwise gobble them up. Well, for those of us who are still growing as Christians, this is a sometimes hostile world. There are forces out there that are bent on eroding our faith, on wearing us down, on separating us from God. And in the face of all of this uncertainty and doubt, in the face of these dangerous and shifting winds, it helps to have protection. It helps to have cover, something to prevent us from being blown away or snatched up. the straw of God's word, including a book like James, can provide us. God's word can anchor us to something more solid than ourselves. It can sustain us as we grow. In times when we're in danger of being swallowed up by anxieties and fears all around us, the word of God can provide a refuge. And maybe I'm pushing the straw metaphor too far in order to make a point. Preachers can sometimes do that. But I don't think it's a stretch to see that the scriptures, including a book like James, are things that can provide fuel for our spiritual fire. They can provide wisdom when we need some direction and refuge when we're under attack. And so over the next couple of months, we're going to be looking at specific passages from James, specific parts of this book, in order to answer some of life's big questions and also some of life's little questions. And my hope is that as we do, we'll come to a deeper awareness of the place of God's word in our lives. That will steer clear of thinking that we know everything there is to know about God's plan for us. And that as a community, as brothers and sisters in Christ, we'll open ourselves to the challenges and the encouragements and the life-changing words that God sends our way. Let's pray. God, we thank you for the gift of Scripture. We realize what a blessing it is, Lord, that we sometimes take for granted, but what a blessing it is that we can open this book, the Bible, and encounter there the story of your people. We can encounter there songs of praise that people have been singing for thousands upon thousands of years. We can encounter their instruction for our lives. We can encounter your promises. And so much more, God. And God, we pray that as we make room for Scripture in our lives, we would do so with hearts and minds that are open to what you have to show us, that are open to being led through your word to Jesus, so that we might carve out space in our lives for him, so that we might make room in our day-to-day existences for his calling and for his commands and for his word. God, help us to truly be people of the book. Help us to truly be people who approach Scripture as a central reality in our lives, and who are shaped by it. And God, we ask all these things so that we might live lives that bring glory to you. That we might point to you, and we might bear witness. It's in the name of your Son, Jesus, that we pray these things. Amen.